Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Alex. I'm a software engineer. Currently, I work at Google, so I build stuff at Google scale, and I break stuff at scale.
We all break stuff. And my name is Mykyta Protsenko. Today, we'll give you an overview of a few patterns, tools, and approaches you can use to build fault-tolerant systems. I hope it will give you some ideas how to improve your system on different levels. By the way, I worked at Netflix, I forgot to tell that. But first of all, what is fault tolerance? What does it mean for your system to be fault tolerant? Does it mean that your system shouldn't have any failures or faults or errors? First, let's tell them apart, because faults, errors, and failures are different things. Modern software systems are built using different components, parts, and layers. Today we have multiple microservices, they talk to each other, and some of components will fail or produce a fault. I know nothing about your system, but I promise that some of its components will produce a fault, and some of them may be failing right now. The more components you have, the more faults you get. Fault is an event of incorrect internal state of your system. High latency of your database is a fault. A hole in your spaceship is a fault. Trees hitting power lines are a fault, but it's not a failure yet. By itself, it's not even an error. An error is a visibly incorrect behavior, is when your system misbehaves and your user notices. It may be returning incorrect results, it may be returning 500s, your lights may be flickering. Your users notice, but the system still works by and large. A failure is when your system doesn't work. It may be unreachable, it may be unresponsive, it may be something else, but the bottom line is the same. Your main functionality is broken. You're facing a blackout. The power is out. It's like in 2003, then 55 million people lost power because of some trees hitting power lines. So a fault like that can cause an error. An error can lead to a failure, sometimes a catastrophic one.
So given these terms, a fault-tolerant system is the one that doesn't crash when fault happens, or when multiple faults occur at the same time. On the other hand, fault-intolerant system will crash and might require a restart after a fault. It will kill itself, and you will need to start it from scratch.
It's even worse, because most modern systems, most complex systems cannot be fixed with a simple restart. It might be impossible or make things worse. Let's take a look at these two famous real-world incidents. What is the difference between those two? Well, one was a catastrophic failure. In another, everybody survived.
And on the first look, Titanic was designed with fault tolerance in mind. Remotely activated watertight doors, bulkheads, lifeboats. But it was just an appearance. In reality, Titanic design missed some crucial fault-tolerant practices. And unfortunately, it ended up in a catastrophe. They hit an iceberg. That was a fault. When water got inside the ship, that was a very visible error that led to a failure. Meanwhile, in 2009, Captain Sullenberg safely landed his plane on the River of Hudson after collision with Canada geese. It was pretty severe and unpredictable fault. When engines went out, it was a clear error. I bet users on that plane noted that. But it wasn't a catastrophic failure because everybody survived. What made the difference? Planes are designed to tolerate faults. We have given up trying to build a perfect plane. Now we are doing our best to embrace fault. We try to improve safety after each incident. So as you can see, a fault can lead to an error, and error can provoke a failure. And this is exactly what we are trying to avoid by building fault-tolerant system. Bad things will happen. We cannot prevent faults, but we should be able to prevent failures. And truly fault-tolerant system should keep running despite the fault, degrading gracefully, not crashing completely.
And fault tolerance requires several things. Right code practices, choosing business priorities, and maintaining a proper communication culture. We are going to cover those topics, talking about design patterns, illustrating them with code snippets, and not just some abstract code snippets. We're actually going to review an application we wrote. We're going to run it live, breaking it and fixing it as we go. And finally, we are going to cover some communication patterns that helps us maintain fault-tolerant systems. Okay, let's check out our game. In the game, we can fly a plane, dodging geese, flying through clouds. We have actually written all the services, compiled them, deployed them to cloud. Let's take a look at them.
Yep, let's take a look. And here's the game. So what you can see on the right, I have a plane with geese and clouds. If I hit a cloud, nothing happens. But if I hit a goose, I lose one engine. After I lose all four engines, game is over for me. But everybody survives anyway. So on the left, you see my username, my score, my engines, and the leaderboard. I'm the only player now, but if there are multiple players, they can compete. So now, as you saw the game, let's check how did we actually build it. What's under the hood? So we have a GitHub repository with all the code. You will be able to check it out later. And our system uses a mix of technologies. Some of the services we implemented using gRPC, and some others with REST. And while we are going to show you some code snippets, this is not talk about gRPC or REST. And if you're not familiar with gRPC, that's fine. Let's talk not about gRPC, and code snippets will be generic. So for those of you who are not aware of gRPC, gRPC is a high-performance remote procedure call framework, open sourced by Google. We use it internally at Google, and it's used in other companies like Netflix. And we'll provide code for a demo and links that you will be able to inspect later. And solutions we are going to review can be implemented with any technology. Sometimes they are easier to implement using gRPC. Sometimes REST is a better fit. But we'll provide you examples for both of them. So we want to show you different flavors of the same patterns where we can, of course. Sending large amount of geese and clouds seems to be a good fit for gRPC, because some of you might remember we had this gRPC versus REST battle last year, and gRPC obviously won. So our first service is geese service. It generates all these geese you saw on the screen, and it's gRPC service. And we need another one for clouds that generates all these clouds, because as you know, geese are birds, and they fly in the clouds. It's not the Java island, so they're not cloud-native Java birds. They are cloud-native geese.
Sound like a name for a book. And we also need a leaderboard to record the distance traveled. The longer you can fly without hitting geese, the better. And we need a gateway to bring all these different services together and provide our web client with a unified gRPC interface. And our web client is written in JavaScript. And it's using gRPC Web, which became generally available just a few weeks ago. Let's review our services in more details now. First, we have RESTful APIs in leaderboard. First, we have a resource. We can query it to get a player score. We can get the data. We can change it. We can send it back to the server. And then we can query another API to get top end score. So we can actually build a leaderboard with top end players and display it to the rest of users.
Okay, and geese service is gRPC service. gRPC uses protobuf as a language to define API, and the very first thing you do in gRPC, you describe your API. If you don't know anything about protobuf, don't worry, it's very readable. So we have a service, geese service. It has one RPC method, getGeese, that takes a request and returns geese response. And geese response contains all those geese you saw on the screen. And little known fact, gRPC stands for geese remote procedure calls. And we have very similar service for clouds that returns clouds response with positions for all those clouds you saw on the screen. And our client is going to call gateway. And gateway has this fixture service. And what is a fixture? Fixture is a combination of geese and clouds. So everything you saw on the screen is actually game fixture, right? In every single line, you can have geese or clouds or both. So getFixture returns fixture response with positions for clouds and for geese. And we are going to use gRPC runtime, or we actually use gRPC runtime. We generated client libraries. We generated service implementations. And now let's go ahead and see how did we implement our fixture service. When client calls fixture service, it calls geese service, and then it calls cloud service. So the easiest, the simplest way to implement it would be something like this. Client calls API gateway. Gateway calls geese, waits for the response. When the response is back, it makes another call to cloud service. When the response is received from cloud service, it combines them together into fixture response and sends fixture response back to the client.
But you have two sequential calls here, so it means that your latency is going to be a sum of their latencies, and that hurts, especially as we scale up.
Well, we don't need to send this request sequentially, one by one. We can send two asynchronous calls in parallel, and then combine their responses when they're ready. So this way, we don't need to sum their latencies up. With gRPC, it's pretty easy. gRPC, by default, provides you future-based stops. So future-based stop is non-blocking. When you make a call on it, it doesn't block the thread. It just returns you a future that will be implemented, that will be completed somewhere in the future when you have response. And when client calls get fixture, we make call to GIS service using future stop for GIS service, and then same call to cloud service. And as these calls are non-blocking, we immediately receive this GIS and cloud future, and we combine them together using method futures all as list. So asynchronous calls help us to send multiple requests in parallel, and this way we don't add their latencies up. But dependencies can be slow. GIS service, cloud service, they can be slow. And if this call takes forever, you don't want your call to take forever. And your users, they will not wait forever for sure.
To fix that, we need to use timeouts. In fact, timeouts are number one caveat of building a distributed application. Timeouts provide predictable latencies for all our dependencies. We should have timeouts for all integration points of our system, for every external network call, for every database call, for every file system call. In fact, the very first thing you can do on Monday when you get back to work is add timeouts in your system if they are missing.
Or on Friday, if you still work on Fridays. And in gRPC, it's pretty easy. When you make your RPC call, you just add with deadline after. So with deadline after 500 milliseconds, you make this call with 500 millisecond deadline or timeout. And then you combine these futures as we did before.
In REST, we use future-based HTTP call as well to avoid blocking a thread. And we also need a timeout so we can get consistent behavior across all our calls.
So timeouts guarantee us predictable latency and protect us from slow dependencies. So let's check out our game again, because we made these calls asynchronous. We protected them with timeouts. What can possibly go wrong?
Famous last words.
Let's check it out.
Yeah, let's check out the game.
Let's check out my cloud native GIS. All right, here's the application, as you already saw. So now you see this feature, service, GIS service, and cloud service. They generate all this awesome GIS and clouds. Right? And now?
Now I don't see any GIS and clouds. They're missing.
That's, I mean, it works for me.
Control U. And leaderboard is missing as well.
Well.
Something is broken. Like, yeah. Let's investigate. We need to find out what happened.
Leaderboard is back.
It's back, but
and
it
I'm
was
the first one in the leader.
Yeah, but it was missing like a few seconds ago. I saw it. So we have two problems here. We have missing clouds, missing GIS, and we have blinking leaderboard. It just blinked. I saw it. Let's find out what's happening.
All right. Okay, so when we have an issue, we've seen an error, right? Visibly incorrect behavior, and we need to investigate it. So, and for an investigation, we need to have good observability. And observability starts with proper monitoring. We need to know technical metrics of our system so we can react when something goes wrong. We need to know requests per second, latencies, error rates for all the services we have. And gRPC by default reports this metrics to OpenCensus. This is an open source version of the framework we internally use at Google to collect those metrics. So it's pretty easy to tell gRPC to start collecting these metrics using OpenCensus. You just register your views and then export them to the monitoring tool of your choice. And those metrics give you an understanding of the service usage and health. But they're not enough. When you're investigating an error, you may want to dig into individual requests, inspect their call flow, latency, and so on. So distributed tracing helps with all that. Tracing provides us visibility into each step of our request. What services did it call? How long did it take? What was the status? And so on. So we can integrate gRPC with open tracing solutions, for example, Zipkin. For gRPC in Zipkin integration, you need to create a tracer, and then you add interceptors when you create your channel and your server. And then gRPC starts reports response to Zipkin, and Zipkin provides very nice UI when you can expect a call flow. We'll show you later.
And in REST universe, there are libraries that can do such instrumentation for you. For example, if you have a Spring Boot application, all you need to do is just add a couple of dependencies and then change your application properties to point to Zipkin collector endpoint. That's it. Okay, let's see what's happening during each step, because we have these tools we can investigate now.
Okay. Are geese back? No.
No, they are not.
Geese are still missing. And let's start with traces, right?
Yeah, why not?
Okay. Here is stack driver view, because we deployed our service to Google Cloud. But you can use another tool. Okay, so all those dots are calls. And as you can see here, now, if I click on a dot, I see the call flow. I see get fixture method, right? It's get fixture, it called get geese, and then get geese called get cloud. First of all, what we see that their latencies are more than 500 milliseconds. And you remember we set deadline to 500 milliseconds. So what happens? Get fixture call, if you scroll down, we see that it produced an error, deadline exceeded. Deadline exceeded is a gRPC timeout. But we see that geese service took only like 5 milliseconds, but cloud service, it failed with deadline exceeded. So let me check out another trace.
Yes, but you're spot checking. For proper investigation, spot checking might not be enough because you only see 2, 3, 5 data points.
Yeah, but all those data points are consistent. I see get fixture. Called get cloud. Get cloud is slow, and it make my entire call fail. But you're right. We have latencies for all the services, and here's the latency for. Let me reload it. Here's the latency for get clouds. Okay. So what you can see here that my even mean latency is over 500 milliseconds. Orange line is the mean latency. Blue line is 99 percentile. So it seems like cloud service is constantly slow. And let me check geese service just to make sure. Just to make sure it's not slow. Okay, here's geese service, and its latency like less than 15 milliseconds, even 99 percentile. It's not that bad. So my current theory that cloud service is slow, and it makes entire call to fail based on the data points we saw.
Okay, that's one theory, but what about leaderboard? Because we saw it blinking.
Right, so here's leaderboard. I filter out top scores. So first of all, I see that all these calls take less than 20 milliseconds. They're pretty fast, which is nice. If I click on them, I see an error. You see Zipkin IO error.
And how many errors do we have there?
Instruct driver allows me to filter it by label, right? So here I filtered out errors. So those are failed calls.
We don't see a lot of errors. It only fails every now and then.
And so these are all the calls. Yeah, there are much more total calls than failed calls. So we have two theories now, right? First off, our cloud service is slow. That makes fixture call to fail. And another is our leaderboard fails from time to time.
OK, we have the data to confirm those theories. And we know that our cloud service is slow all the time. And that may lead to a gateway timeout. Let's fix it now. We know that the whole call fails when one of the dependencies fails, and we can partially degrade our functionality by not returning clouds when cloud call is failing, because clouds are not a critical part of our system. It's fine to skip clouds. And to fix that, we need to switch from futures all as list to futures successful as list. And it will return only successful results, and failed responses like failed clouds will be just ignored. This pattern is called partial degradation.
Okay, but let's see if we can improve user experience. When leaderboard disappears, it's annoying. And we know that all leaderboard calls that we saw are fast, but some of them produce an error. So what we can do?
We can retry a leaderboard call, because we know that it is successful most of the time. And it's very fast, so if we retry the call, we probably will get a good result next time, and it won't take long. So to do that, we need to wrap our future-based call in a function, and then we need to define our retry policy. Let's say we want to retry up to 5 times, and then we're using failsafe library to apply this policy to provide us with a retryable REST call. Retries, they give us a better user experience when we're dealing with intermittent failures. Let's try our fixes actually now.
Okay.
I'm going to deploy them to production.
Because the only way to verify that we are right is to deploy those fixes and check if they helped. Otherwise, it's still a hypothesis.
Okay, my changes should be live now. Let's check them out.
Let's check them out. And where are my... Okay, my cloud native geese are back. Okay.
But they're not cloud native anymore. We don't have clouds.
No clouds, but geese are there. And leaderboard does not disappear, right?
Yeah, it's not blinking anymore. It seems to be working. Let's check the traces just to make sure we're not cheating there.
Yeah, that's right. Let me reload them real time. And 7 minutes ago, okay, just now. Here is the latest trace I have. It still takes 501 milliseconds. But this call didn't fail. You see, there is no error. But if I click on get clouds call, I see that it failed with deadline exceeded status code. But fixture call just ignored this failure. So we partially degraded our system. So this call is somewhat slow, but we can still play a game. So it seems it helped, right? And leaderboard, as we saw, didn't disappear. So our retries helped for leaderboard.
Hooray, our fixes work.
Right, but you might be wondering why we retried on leaderboard calls, but we didn't retry on cloud calls.
Well, we know that clouds fail all the time. And adding a retry to the call that timeouts doesn't make sense, because by the time your dependency timed out, your main call has timed out as well. And you will be adding more latency to the call that is already failing. It's all for nothing. So you need to decide which faults are retryable and which are not. For example, you may want to retry on network failures and don't retry on timeouts.
Yes, and in gRPC, if you enable retries, by default it will retry on unavailable status code, but it will not retry on deadline exceeded, which makes perfect sense.
And with retries, we are increasing a number of requests to a service that may be sick already, and adding load to the sick service doesn't help, it hurts more, we can kill it actually.
That's right, this well-known anti-pattern is called retry storm. And how do we avoid it?
Well, sick services, they need some breathing room, and we can provide that breathing room by using exponential backoff. For example, after a first failed request, we may want to wait 100 milliseconds. After the second one, we may want to wait 200 and 400 after the third one, and so on and so on.
But what if I don't want to retry a failed call?
Well, we may rely on a fallback. We can just provide a hard-coded failure, like an empty leaderboard. Or even better, we can rely on the last known good value, because stale leaderboard is better than no leaderboard. Or we can throw an exception right away. If you pay for something with your credit card, you don't want to rely on your cached account balance, and you want to avoid retries so you don't get duplicate charges. And that must be a product decision, not a technical one.
But there is a technical caveat as well. You can only retry those calls that are idempotent, meaning multiple calls will leave the system in the same state. And as we discussed, retrying every single call is not the best idea, especially for slow calls. And speaking of slow calls, here's somewhat typical latency distribution. What we see here, that mean latency is not bad. It's less than 50 milliseconds, I would say. But in 99th percentile, it's more than 500 milliseconds.
But overall, it's not so bad. Mean latency is really low, and most of the requests are fast.
That's right. Most of the requests. It means one out of 100 requests will take more than 500 milliseconds, and it will time out. It's called tail latency. With tail latency, if we have a client that sends 100 requests a minute, each of them has 1% probability to time out. What is the chance the user will face a timeout? Any guesses?
Well, it's the whole 63%. If a user sees an error with more than 50% probability each minute, this user is going to be very unhappy. So when you scale up, a typical tail latency may lead to unusable system and to unhappy users. How can we fix that?
We need to be tail tolerant. If we send a request with 200 millisecond deadline, and there is no response in 100 milliseconds. At this point, we know that our call is kind of slow, so we can preemptively issue a second call. It's not a retry, because deadline is not reached yet. Now we have two requests in flight, and we use the first response from any of these two calls. This approach is called request hedging. This way, we can reduce our tail latency, and the probability of a timeout drops from 63% to less than 1%. So it can be a good trade-off to sacrifice some throughput for better tail latencies and better user experience. And gRPC will soon support request hedging out of the box. Stay tuned. In one of the next releases, you will need to enable retry and set max hedge attempts, and it will do request hedging for you. So request hedging is useful when not all of your requests are slow, and second call has a good chance to return faster. And request hedging helps us to achieve tail tolerance.
But what if we have another kind of latency distribution? This kind of graph is very common when you have a dependency that is overloaded. Let's do some math. If we have a mean latency that exceeds our timeout threshold, then each request has more than 50% probability of failure. And with 100 requests, we get almost 100% of seeing a timeout in 100 calls, and hedging or retries, they're not going to help much there in the real world. Well, it doesn't make sense to whip a dying horse. It's better to give it a chance to recover, and we can do it by stopping all traffic to affected service altogether with no request. It can recover or it can restart. We still need to issue a health check every now and then, so when it passes, we can resume the normal traffic flow. This pattern is called a circuit breaker, and it's implemented by such libraries as Hysterix or Failsafe. It lets us fail fast, and failing fast is one more strategy of processing an error. Now you can choose what to do when your service is unavailable or slow, and again, it must be a product decision.
And with slow services, we have at least one more issue. Client can already fail with a timeout, but if services are not aware of that, they can still make these outgoing calls and overload the system. We need to properly choose deadlines that can be not that easy. Let's say we have a client that calls a gateway, and gateway calls cloud service, and cloud service can call another service, like weather service, for example, to figure out how many clouds to put on the screen. And if client has 200 millisecond deadline, and API gateway spent 120 millisecond processing this request, and it makes a call to cloud service, then cloud service works for another 90 millisecond. At this point, deadline is exceeded, and client failed. But cloud service can be unaware of that, and it still can decide to make a call to weather service. These calls are wasting resources, propagate slowness, and overload the system. gRPC helps us to avoid these issues with deadline propagation. What it means? It means that if we make a request with 200 millisecond deadline, an API gateway spends 120 processing this request, an outgoing call from API gateway to clouds will have only 80 millisecond deadline. gRPC automatically adjusts deadline based on time already spent. And if clouds works for another 90 millisecond, and client already failed with deadline exceeded, gRPC will not even try to make this call to weather service because it knows that client is not waiting for the response anymore. So now we're not wasting our time and resources for the request that already failed on caller side. This is one more pattern that helps us to make sure our system is not overloaded, and gRPC gives it to you out of the box.
We know what kind of latency we can handle using deadline propagation and timeouts, and after we do load tests, we know how much throughput we can handle, and we know that additional throughput will lead to degraded performance, and how do we address that?
So we can start rejecting requests over some known healthy limit. For example, if we know that our system can handle 1,000 simultaneous requests, we can drop 1,000 first. This is called load shedding.
But how do we find that limit?
A good question. The best load test is the one that you run in production. When your service starts queuing up incoming requests, you know that you may hit your limit. And at this moment, you can just start rejecting everything above this limit. This way we don't overload the system and keep it healthy.
This approach is called adaptive concurrency limits. Netflix has open sourced the library to address exactly this problem. And the name of the library, can you guess it?
G concurrency limits.
Well, it's not Google, it's Netflix, so the name is just concurrency limits. The name is not fancy, but the library works, and it supports both REST and gRPC in REST. All you need to do is add a servlet filter and specify an initial limit, which will be adjusted later.
But this way, you limited throughput for all the users and all the requests, right? What if I have premium users and I have free users in my system, and I want to guarantee throughput for premium users even when free users are overwhelming the system?
Well, we can partition our traffic. We, for example, here we are partitioning it by an HTTP header, so we guarantee 90% of the throughput for our premium geese. Pay for your geese to get guaranteed throughput. And again, prioritizing request types must be a product decision.
And you can use it in gRPC as well. You create this limiter. We can partition by header, we can partition by method, by other things. And then you create interceptor and you add this interceptor when you create gRPC server. In addition, library provides us client concurrency limits, protecting upstream services from the caller side. The approach is the same. We limit number of concurrent requests to a given upstream service to avoid overloading it. And as we can see, concurrency limits helps us to provide predictable throughput.
Phew, that's a lot. Concurrency limits, deadline propagation, timeout. Let's try it on scale. Anybody wants to play the game, take your phones or open your tablets. Alex has shown you the URL you can go to. It's breakit.xyz, breakit.xyz.
And put it in landscape mode. This is how it works. So you'll be able to control this plane with your phone.
Yes, and we are going to have a small competition here. We saw the leaderboard, and the winner of that competition, the best pilot, is going to get this awesome stuffed Canada geese.
Goose, and glory, of course.
And, of course, some glory. And while people are playing, let's check our metrics, because we talked about observability. And good observability, it comes in layers. And the first layer that we have is application performance monitoring. And it provides us some basic health metrics like CPU usage or memory. But we also need to know things such as QPS or latency to see how our services perform. So here we are seeing...
QPS, we see you guys are playing.
Yes, we
see. Thank you for doing it. It has a little... I think it has delay, but you see that QPS went up at least.
Yes. Yes, we see that it's going. But that's not all. Because we also need to investigate stuff sometimes, right? And to investigate stuff.
Yep, we need tracing, right?
And yes, we need traces, absolutely.
So we already show you those traces. Let me reload these traces so I have the latest one. And yeah, I see that get fixture calls, they're pretty fast. They like take few milliseconds only just now. Oh, nice.
Yeah, it's working better.
Yep, but even that is not enough, right?
Yes, because by the end of the day, you need to understand the impact of your code on your business. You need to see your business performance, and for that, you need business metrics, which will also provide you insight into your customer's behavior.
And it's extremely important to design your system for observability from day one. Design not to find only something that happened, for example, like exception is thrown, but designed to find something that didn't happen. For example, you didn't record any leaderboard updates in the last 2 minutes, which means something probably is wrong with your system.
And speaking of leaderboard, I believe we can go out and check the game and announce our winner. And if you're the winner, please don't close the application so we can know
just
that
take
you
a screenshot.
Is really you when you come to claim your prize at the end of the talk.
Yep, just take a screenshot of your...
Yes, let's wait. And the winner is...
It's not me.
Yeah, it's Pilot 9, right? Pilot 9.
Let's wait for a few more.
No, we saw it. We saw it.
Nice. Okay,
Pilot
9
is the winner. Do we have it? Okay, come to see us after.
Now close your phone, please, and listen to the presentation. All right.
Phew, our system has survived the conference test.
That's right. And we've seen some of the code and design practices that we use to make our system fault tolerant, and we saw them working. And some of them you can see on the screen. But you know what? Truly high-loaded application should be able to handle much more requests, of course. Let's review what we could change to make it even more efficient. Right now, we are making not a single call, but like 100,000 calls for geese and clouds, and those requests are exactly the same. Responses are different. Positions for geese and clouds, they change, but request doesn't change at all. So those calls are redundant. What if we could send only one request and then listen for the responses as they come? This looks like a streaming solution. gRPC supports streaming out of the box. So all you have to do, you have to add stream modifier when you define your service. And now you switch from unary communication from one-to-one to streaming communication. With streaming, client can send only one request and receive many responses on the same request. You just open the streaming connection and listen for the responses. And the stream of geese can be even unlimited.
But that can be a little bit dangerous, because what if I don't have the capacity to process all the responses? Because when I do polling, I know if I can process a response. If I cannot, I just don't make the request. But with streaming, I can get all these responses that can kill my client.
Even with streaming, we can tell our server when we are ready to receive messages and how many responses we can process. This approach is called back pressure, or in gRPC it's called flow control. We can open streaming connection and then ask our server to send us up to 5 responses. And when we process them, we can ask for 3 more and so on. And when we receive them, we can ask for more and more. And flow control, or back pressure, is a collaboration between consumer and producer, between client and server. It helps us to balance their capacities and make sure none of them is overloaded.
Speaking of being asynchronous, why don't make the system fully reactive? We can put a message broker between producer and consumer, so producer can write there, like put in mail in the mailbox, and the client can just get just read from this mailbox, because reactive systems are great for fault tolerance.
First of all, this topic deserves its own talk. It's outside of the scope, and I agree, reactive systems are awesome. When we switch to message-driven system, we decoupled producers and consumers, and we decoupled their failures. Components are isolated. When server has a fault or an error, client doesn't have to handle it directly. It doesn't need timeout, it doesn't need circuit breakers. It just waits for the response, for this mail in the mailbox, while server is still recovering. But it comes at a price. Reactive systems are much more complicated. They require more components, which you will need to maintain. Think about dropped, reordered, duplicated messages, eventual consistency, managing concurrent state, managing race conditions. It may be much harder to enforce latency limits. I mean, reactive systems are great, but you should think twice if you really need them and if you are ready to invest into building them.
But if your system is not built to be reactive from day one, for example, you might be working on a legacy system, it will cost you quite an effort to make it reactive later. Well, we have reviewed a few solutions to make your code fault tolerant, and we have spoken about their pros and cons, but no matter how good your code is, there is only so much traffic one instance can handle.
That's right, there are always capacity limits. It's like that door on Titanic, in the Titanic movie. Do you remember this scene at the end of the movie? There was a door, and it didn't have enough capacity to support both Jack and Rose, or it did.
Have you ever asked yourself why Jack and Rose didn't share the door?
Well, it's simple. According to James Cameron, Jack had to die. It was in the script. But we hope you don't want your system to die, so you have to understand its real capacity.
So when you scale your system, you need to understand its capacity. If we go back to Titanic example, you can see it totally missed the mark when it came to this practice. They underestimated lifeboat's capacity, and it contributed to the tragedy. So we need to provision enough capacity to handle our load. And autoscaling is a pattern that helps us exactly with that. You can add and remove instances without spending too much money on unused capacity or without choking up on traffic spikes.
And when you auto-scale, you need to understand your bottlenecks. If you're network-bound, you should scale on bandwidth. If you're CPU-bound, you should scale on CPU. And even auto-scaling is not a silver bullet. Sometimes you should scale ahead of time. It's called pre-scaling. A good example of pre-scaling is scaling before holidays or sales or promotion events. When your service is on the brink of failure, scaling and redirecting traffic may create additional stress that can break it. It may be too late to auto-scale. So pre-scale and don't be fast to scale down. Traffic drop can be temporary. Make sure the peak has passed before you decide to scale down.
And let's not forget about state. Because if your system is 100% stateless, it's easy to scale up or down. But if you have state, you need to decide what to do with that. Because changes in your state may affect the whole system.
So we need to be aware of the state and interactions within the system, right?
Yes, we do, because one service may affect other services. And even within the same service, you may have parts that can break other parts. It's like with our example with free geese. If we have too many of them, then they may affect our premium geese.
And how do we fix it?
With bulkheads. We need to build a wall between different parts of our system or even within the same service. So different geese types don't affect each other. You see, our free geese are dead, but premium geese are alive and happy.
But Titanic had bulkheads as well.
And they had a constructive flow. They let water spill over the top. So when you build your bulkheads, you need to make sure that isolation is real. For example, if you're dealing with in-process bulkheads, you need to use separate thread pools, separate connection pools. You need to avoid using shared resources to the best of your ability.
But we almost always have external dependencies, and free geese can affect them as well, right? Army of incoming free geese can overload my external dependencies. Can I deal with it just within my process?
Actually, you can. You can separate the outgoing requests and limit them by request type. Or if you want, you may go the other direction and keep your code simple. You can build integrating bulkheads, isolating the whole families of services. You may have one set of geese and cloud and gateway services for your premium geese and another set for your free geese, and you can scale them independently using different limits.
So as we can see, the bulkhead is a generic pattern that can be implemented on a different level. You can add bulkheads in your code, you can split your services, or you can even go up and implement bulkheads on infrastructure level. Also, bulkheads helps you to limit blast radius. They make sure that even if you make an error, it won't kill the entire system. They establish boundaries.
And natural boundaries for limiting blast radius for your deployments might be availability zones. It means when you do a deployment, you deploy to one zone only, zone A, and then you make sure you didn't break anything. And only then you proceed to deploy into zone B, zone C, and so on. Speaking of deployments, I have another change that I would like to deploy. It's live now. You can check it out if you want
while we are checking the metric.
Yep.
Did you improve the system?
Well, let's check out the metrics. It should tell us.
Sure, because we have this metrics and now we can tell. Okay, I don't see any regression here, but let me check out QPS.
I'm getting some weird looks from the end of the audience.
So guys, you can play now.
Yeah.
They like it.
Well, some of the people, they don't seem too happy. I don't know.
Like, it's fine. Some people are happy, some people are not. I mean, it's fine.
Let's
check
traces.
Sure, no problem. Let's check traces. You see those traces? I mean, they take like few milliseconds. And they don't, I mean, no errors, few milliseconds. I mean, it's awesome.
But they have a weird feeling that something is broken. Let's check out the game itself.
Well, you don't believe metrics?
Well, I have this feeling inside of me.
You shouldn't believe feelings. You should believe data.
Well, game is the data.
Yeah, I see. Clouds and geese and everything
what's next?
Works. Play again. Sure, I'll play again.
Can you dodge these geese, right? It's like an army of geese. You cannot play that.
That's probably like a boss level, you know? It's like the last level of the game.
It's game over level. Like, obviously, like it's a bad user experience and our metrics didn't help us at all. We need to do something about it.
Okay, it seems like... our metrics was not enough, right?
Yes, they were
because
not.
We observed bad user experience. What we can do? We can schedule a call to our system from an outside location. This call can verify that our system doesn't break some functionality, some basic functionality. So we can check availability, make sure system is up and reachable. We can check latency SLOs, its latency within required boundaries. And we can perform a smoke test. Verify response against some simple business rules, like geese are present and geese are not taking the whole screen. It would make game impossible to play. And this pattern is called prober. And you can take a look at the Cloud Prober tool, open sourced by Google. In a nutshell, Prober helps us to verify that system works as expected from consumer's point of view. On top of that, inside our system, of course, we should report those business metrics, like number of geese per line, scores, duration of the game, and not only report them, but compare them against some baseline. So it could give us an insight into user experience.
Well, if we had metrics like those, we could decide to roll back our changes, because when you're dealing with bad release, the first thing you want to do is to roll back your changes to the last known good states.
Okay, go and roll it back.
Yes, and rollbacks must be easy. Fortunately, our rollbacks are. So I'm rolling the change back, and I'm verifying it on my box.
And when you are rolling back, you should communicate it to the rest of your team, and then fix the bug without worrying too much. And communication is as important as technical solutions. Without it, people might step on each other's toes or forget something small but important.
Like on Titanic, when they forgot to pass a key to a locker with binoculars in it and they didn't tell anybody about it. And without binoculars, they didn't notice the iceberg until it was too late. So you see, the smallest communication issues can lead to huge failures.
And to prevent failures, you need to establish the right culture. People should make a habit of exchanging information. If you break something, it should be easy to ask for help or advice. And when you face an incident or notice something suspicious, you will benefit from having real-time conversation. You must establish roles and communication channels ahead of time. You need to agree on how and where to send those messages, who should respond to them and within what time limits, how to bring new people into discussion, how to escalate. So when something bad happens, you don't have to think whom to call and how to reach them. And during the incident, please don't be afraid to over-communicate.
Because it's better to come up with a false alarm than to see something and ignore it. And when something bad actually happens, you get a chance to learn. It's okay to have a failure, but it's wrong to have the same type of failure over and over. So when you have a failure, you need to do a post-mortem. You need to establish a timeline of events that led to it so you can understand its causes and so you can decide what you can do, what you can fix to make sure it doesn't happen again.
And it's extremely important to keep those postmortems blameless and constructive. The natural reaction when things go wrong is to find for a guilty party. Please don't. Instead, make sure people can exchange information freely. Removing blame from a postmortem gives people the confidence to bring up issues without fear. Sharing information about mistakes helps others. Collect all the data you have. Track the causes. Share the results of blameless postmortems. You can even introduce monthly meetings to review postmortems of incidents happened not only in your team, but in your organization or in your entire company. It makes great learning opportunity as well as a social event. Free food and drink never hurt anybody.
Well, let's do a quick postmortem here. We know we had an incident, an unplayable game. We can establish a timeline. We know that everything was fine. Then I deployed the change. Then everything was broken.
And we were lucky because in real system, it usually takes more than one change to produce a failure. So good investigation and proper data collection are important.
And I made sure that rolling back the change fixed the issue. And what can we do to prevent it from happening?
So first of all, we should report business metrics to have better understanding of the system state. And then we should add automated rollbacks based on those metrics.
Cool. Now we know how to improve our system.
And I didn't blame you.
We didn't blame anybody.
And where is my free beer?
We can definitely get some beer. I heard Belgian beer is really good. And we also need to make notes, because history of past incidents will be valuable later. It certainly beats the tribal knowledge. Like, I believe I have seen an incident like that, or maybe not. So build a knowledge base and act on it. Share the information, keep learning, and keep make your system fault tolerant.
And here are some of the libraries and tools we use to make our system more transparent and fault tolerant. You might benefit from them as well. So we will share slides and you will be able to check them out. And the very first link is the code of our demo. So we have all the services, all the code there.
Yes, and speaking of the code, we would like to thank Evgen, who wrote the whole code of our UI part. Thank you, Evgen.
Thank you, Evgen. If you want to learn more about building fault-tolerant systems, you can start with these books. And remember that there is no silver bullet. Good fault tolerance is not achieved overnight. Fault tolerance is a combination of right code and design patterns, good product decisions, and proper communication culture.
And we would like to emphasize that no geese were harmed during making of this talk.
And organizers asked us to add this rate me slide, and we improved it. So rate us if you can.
Or provide the feedback so we can make the talk better. Unfortunately, we have no time for questions. So please come and see us after the talk to claim your prize or just talk to us. We'll be happy to see you. And thank you all for coming here.
Thank you.